Welcome to the Prophecy Club. I've got Jonathan Wright on the phone today. He is going to be our speaker March 14 and 15. He's going to be speaking at the Prophecy Club. That's Saturday night and Sunday morning. Saturday night, the 14th, and that starts at 7 p.m. And then Sunday morning at 9:30, and that's at the Prophecy Club, 2540 K Avenue in Plano behind the Whataburger. Prophecy Club, 2540 K Avenue behind the Whataburger in Plano. Now, in case you're not familiar with this story here, the whole Bible Code thing all got started with Michael Drosnin. He had written this book called The Bible Code. He was an agnostic that actually found a code which accurately predicted the death of Yitzhak Rabin. Now, Matthew bought a Bible Code program to verify what they were saying. Not only did he verify what they said, but he found more, much more, and he saw the prophecies in those Bible Codes. Turns out that the Jewish rabbis didn't really want people to even discover these Bible Codes, and especially the secrets that Drosnin had revealed. But now what Jonathan has found has totally blown the lid off of it. He started putting some of his ideas on the internet, and it has just blown up into now a full-time job for him. And so we're having him in to make a new DVD called Prophecies in the Bible Code. Yes, that is available through Prophecy Club for a gift of $40, I think. Call and they'll tell you all about it. But anyway, Jonathan, welcome to the Prophecy Club.
Thank you, Stan. Thanks for having me.
Okay, so tell us how you got started in the Bible Code.
Well, I was given a book back in the 90s from Michael Drosnin, The Bible Code. He's written three books, and that was my first connection to the Bible Code. This is what was all new to me. I didn't know anything about Bible Code. It sparked an interest in me. I found out later that Michael Drosnin, well, he is a Washington Post reporter, and he had heard about this phenomenon from his Jewish circles in Jerusalem about the Torah codes. And the Torah codes is what the rabbis search, which is the first five books of the Bible. These rabbis had been accurately predicting things and finding revelation since the 1970s and had not brought this kind of thing to the mainstream. But Michael Drosnin heard about it and decided to write an expose about it. He was really out trying to debunk God is what he was trying to do. What happened to him is God confounded him, gave him a predictive code, which was the assassination of Yitzhak Rabin 1 year before it actually happened. It is documented that he actually got a note to the Secret Service to Rabin, and Rabin actually heard about this in the code. Now, Rabin, also an agnostic, did not put anything into the Bible, didn't believe it, didn't think nothing else about it. And 1 year later, he was assassinated, just like the code said. Now, the table that Michael Drosnin did on this had every detail. Even after the fact, when they found out who the shooter was, the shooter's name was there right across the term. Now, when I saw this, this really got me. I just couldn't believe that there was such a thing that God had in the Bible that had all these details about future events. And I didn't understand why God would put something there like as if it was a crystal ball. I later discovered that this is not what God intended. It wasn't for us to use as a crystal ball, but he does have the knowledge of the beginning and the end of everything that will take place. And so to give somebody a predictive code like that, it seemed to me like he was putting it on the mainstream. And that's exactly what Michael Drosnin did. He brought it out to the public where the rabbis would have never shared this. And from there, you know, I wanted to know for myself. So when the program was available and I found it, I went and got it and went from there. It started out just a curiosity.
Now, this is a computer program. What did it cost?
It's about $75 for the Code Finder program. Another one I got was TorahSoft. That was a free download, by the way, from a mathematician from Jerusalem. It's no longer, you can't find it on the internet now because the site was destroyed by a hacker. But we were able to save it onto a hard drive, and a couple of us use it today. It's one of my favorites. It's one that Drosnin used. It's one that the rabbis use. It's in Hebrew. The Code Finder program is actually a top of the line. It's got English, Greek, Hebrew, and it's also got what's called monkey text that you can do controlled experiments to see if there's any anomalies in books like Gone with the Wind or Moby Dick and things like that. Some of your listeners may have heard that there are codes in every book, like Moby Dick and things like that. Well, with Code Finder, you can actually test those books and see for yourself that is not the case. You can find random anomalies. For instance, Kennedy and the word shot may come together random in one of these books. But to take it further than that, you really can't do that.
Let's talk about how they do the code. Now, we had Yitzhak Ramshel in here a few years ago before his death to make a DVD. And the way he explained it is, he said, if you take the entire Old Testament, same thing with the New Testament, and you take all of these Hebrew letters and put it into one big square, and then you can find every letter, like, say, an equal distance spacing. And what he explained is you can spell in the first five books of the Bible every 50 words. So it spells the word Torah, and you've actually done this with the entire Bible. Sometimes it's every third letter, every 50 letter, every 100 letter. It spells a word, and then sometimes it goes up and down across the code. Sometimes it's diagonal, sometimes it's backwards. But many times when you find a scripture talking about something in the Bible, like, for example, Moses and the snake example, then you will find certain codes having to do with that there. If you were to go to, for example, some of the codes where it's talking about Babylon or America and the fall of America, in those same scriptures, you find additional codes talking about America, for example, correct?
That's correct. You know, the Old Testament and New Testament go together as one book. It's been said that the Old Testament is the New Testament concealed, and
yes,
the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed.
Right.
Now, another witness to this would be the codes. It verifies both throughout the Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, and God is not bound by language. So it's not only in the Hebrew, it's also in Greek. We were talking earlier about sealed books, the book of Revelation. It says in the very last part of Revelation not to change or add to this book. Now, at the time that that was written, Revelation was a book itself. It was not connected to the Bible. Now, why did the writer put in this not to change anything? It's my theory that it's because it's a sealed book. It's encoded. And if you change or add to anything in there, it destroys the code. It's the same way with Daniel. Daniel is another encoded book, sealed, and for the end times. I find it really interesting that one of the greatest minds in history, Isaac Newton, and you can research this yourself and find out that from the Cambridge papers that they found, it was revealed that Newton spent about 75% of his private time when he was in isolation counting letters by hand. Now, what's really amazing is this great mind was bound by his time. There was no computers. Had this man had access to a computer at that time, he would have unlocked God knows what, but he was bound by his time, did not have computers, and was only able to count by hand. Therefore, you know, just a guy like me in these times with an access to a computer has greater access to the codes than someone that was counting by hand, but which, by the way, could take hundreds of years to find a code.
When we're talking about counting by hand, try to imagine the entire Bible in one, you folks out there listening, one big giant square. To go through and count, say, every 46th letter all the way through the Bible, and then determine which one of those might be a word, or do it backwards, or to do it diagonal, or to do it top to bottom or bottom to top. That could take centuries to be able to search just one word through the Bible like that. But the Bible, or the computers now, can do it almost instantly, correct?
What it does is it the algorithms in the program puts the code or the text on a cylinder. It wraps it around it like a spiral around a cylinder. And that width of that cylinder is based on where the vertical term that you're looking for, which is this is almost like a combination lock, brother, that we're doing. The very first term that you search is called an access term. It will appear vertical. Wherever God put it, there's a specific width that cylinder will be located on. And once you find that, now you have a matrix that you can search. It goes from there. Every term that you find from there is a priori or post priori term, which is known or unknown facts about any particular subject. Now, my original studies when I started searching this was historical facts, things that can be, you know, shown in history. That's exactly what the rabbis were doing in their great experiments. They were looking for past rabbis and all kinds of details about history. Jonas Salk and you know, the age of the space race. They found all the satellites that were put in the outer space. I mean, all kinds of experiments that they did that they could verify historical things. Well, I did the same thing. I just started out doing history, and then it moved into Jesus tables, you know, like Isaiah 53. On the surface, the prophet is talking cryptically about the Messiah. If you look at it coded, it verifies what the plain text has said. As a matter of fact, that specific chapter, Isaiah 53, Yaakov Ramzel found Yeshua is my name in that. And that is one of the most amazing tables I've ever seen. It's just a slam dunk for Yeshua or Jesus being the Messiah right there in Isaiah 53 in the coded text. It's amazing to me. From there, I moved on to things like the two witnesses. And
which are, you know, let's talk about that. Now you got my attention. Okay. So what does the code say the two witnesses are?
Well, that's really interesting because you don't have a huge list to run down. It's pretty simple when you got a limited number of folks that this could be. You've got, you know, John, Moses, Enoch, and Elijah. We know it's Elijah from, you know, the prophecies in
Malachi 4:5. Yes. Yes.
That's right. One of them is identified. So it's a matter of finding the other. And it's a process of elimination. And hands down, brother, and I get plenty of arguments saying that this is not so. They want to believe it's Moses. But hands down, it shows Enoch and Elijah are the two witnesses, which makes a lot of sense because they were both taken and were not did not face death.
Have researched John then, and John wasn't there.
John was not there, no.
Okay,
not as strong as Enoch and Elijah together.
Okay, so in other scriptures, other places, hands down, no question, the two witnesses are Enoch and Elijah.
Yes, and I've searched it every way I could. You know, mentioning of two candlesticks, the two olive trees, the words two witnesses, the names Enoch and Elijah, they appear one time in the text as an access term. And I find that very fascinating. If they were not the witnesses, why are they there together? And the text that verifies them as a witness as well, right there in that one matrix. So, you know, it didn't take long before I was very confident that it was Enoch.
We'll be right back after this message. Shocking heresy and blasphemy. Using over 100 video clips, you will see large, well-known ministers making shocking statements contrary to the Bible. So bad, you'll have to see it to believe it. See, some of most popular pastors seduce you with lying signs and wonders. Teach a false Christ. Yes, it is true. Your mouth will fall open. The worst sins of the Bible in these DVDs called Error in the Church. Nation-killing sins in America. You won't be disappointed. You'll be furious, beyond angry. I thank God that Leslie showed me these shocking errors, and I would never have known it or believed it if I had not actually seen it. Call today and give a $50 gift, and we will immediately ship you the first three DVDs. 30 days later, we'll charge your card for the second $50 gift, then send you the final eight DVDs totaling 11 DVDs. 30 days later, we'll charge the third $50 gift. 30 days later, the fourth and final $50 gift, making it easy for you to get this fantastic set of 11 DVDs. That is four monthly gifts of $50 each. Error in the Church, 13 topics, 11 DVDs, valued at $330. Get started today for a gift of just $50. Call 785-266-1112 and ask them for the Error in the Church offer. $50 donation gets you three DVDs heading your way today. Error in the Church, 785-266-1112. Error in the Church, 785-266-1112. Call today. And now, back to the program.
You know, it didn't take long before I was very confident that it was Enoch.
Okay, let me just give you my comment on that, because you just upset my apple cart. because, you know, in Revelation verse, I want to say 11:19, it says that thou must prophesy again before many peoples, nations, languages, and tongues, and kings. And he's talking to John the Revelator. So to me, that would mean that unless John got off the island of Patmos, and he didn't, according to Fox's Book of Martyrs, then he must come back and prophesy again to fulfill that. So I would say that, and what I have said, is John is a high candidate to be one of the two witnesses. The other witness, would, and since John wrote the book of Revelation, who would the Jews listen to most about the prophecies of the Old Testament? And that would be Moses. So my two votes were Moses and John. So I learned something. Okay, go ahead, tell us more.
All right. Now, well, this is the case with Moses. Every one of these tables about the two witnesses, there's one verse in there, either God's telling Moses, you will not go over the Jordan, or Moses is telling the people, I cannot go over the Jordan, I won't be going with you. And I find that really interesting in a two witness table where it's showing that Moses can't cross over the Jordan. You know, and then the people say, well, what about in Matthew when they go up on the mountain, you know, Peter, James, and John.
Transfiguration.
And they see the transfiguration. And so at the Mount Transfiguration, Peter, James, and John go up to the mountain with Jesus. Now, if we back up, the key to understanding Matthew 17 is what happens at the end of Matthew 16, where Jesus says, "What is it a man profit if he should gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of the Father and his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works. Then he says, verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. And that's very key to understanding what happens at the Transfiguration, because there's three of them standing there that will not die until they see the kingdom. And that's exactly what they saw at the Transfiguration. And we know this because in the millennial kingdom, we will be required, even as Gentiles, to go to Jerusalem to Sukkot, to celebrate tabernacles. And what is the first thing that Peter wants to do when he sees this? He wants to build sukkahs. So that's telling you that Peter thinks that he's seeing the kingdom right there. Jesus tells him, no, that's not what's taking place, and don't tell anybody what you saw. The reason for that was Moses had been dead for 1,500 years. If he had come down off that mountain and said he just saw Moses, they would have stoned him for divination, you know, for talking to dead people. So that was why that was. Peter realized later that even his interpretation of what he was seeing was wrong. He didn't understand the fullness of the Gentiles, the church age, that Jesus was going to bring in the Gentiles, the grafting into the Gentiles. So he was off on his interpretation. But we get an idea of what he was thinking by what he says. So that, to me, he saw the kingdom. He didn't see the two witnesses.
And the Bible codes help you to understand that how?
Not just the codes, but just the Jewish idioms and the Jewish understandings of the feast. You know, he was obviously looking at the, you know, something that hasn't taken place yet. Moses hadn't come out of the grave yet. He was still a part of Abraham's bosom. That took place when Jesus was crucified and raised from the dead. Those people came out of the grave. And then, you know, people say, well, it's got to be Moses. Like you just said, he's the one that they're going to receive this, you know, in the end times. But if Moses died once and he comes back as a witness, why would he be dying twice? He'd be required to die, right, as a witness.
Well, you made a good point. Okay, let's move on to an actual matrix here. What about the fall of America in these Bible codes?
Very interesting table. Yeah, that came one night. I was looking at, you know, what was going on in the country, and let me just pull that one up. And some of the things that was going on, you know, the gay marriage issue, you know, we're in over 40 years in the abortion issue.
Do you have whereabouts in the Bible you found this matrix? What scriptures?
I don't have it right in front of me, but it's mostly in the Old Testament. But yeah, abortion is directly connected with the access term. Also, there's the mention of a year, 2015, in the plain text, right there. It's what I call an abacus anomaly, where it's a matter of pushing letters together. It doesn't normally appear in the plain text, but it's just a matter of moving one letter left or right. You've got a date, and that is 2015. We were talking just a minute ago about the years 2015, 2016. They come up repeatedly in the codes. Now, I've noticed this for about 3 years, just running a series of years, decades usually, controlled and current years, and just see what sticks. For instance, when you run in the Fall of America, I just started running years, decades at a time, and see whatever comes up. And consecutively, 2015, 2016 seem to be very important years, like there's a transition going on there of something. I saw the same thing for 2012, by the way. And that's something that happened with some other rabbis. They put together a documentary called Torah Code 2012, and it was all about the anomalies they were finding with 2012. Of course, the Mayan calendar and everything that was indicating something was going to happen in 2012. And then nothing did. Well, what it looks like in the codes is a transition period. And I go back to Matthew 24, where we're given an outline by Jesus of the end times. And we're given terms like the time of sorrows, end of an era, abomination of desolation. All of these things that seem like searchable terms begin to paint a picture of the end times. And
let me just read some words here. I'm looking at your particular matrix here on the Fall of America now. And folks, I'll just read some terms, and this is part of what he's going to be doing when he's speaking, is explaining all of these. In this one particular area concerning the Fall of America, I see the words, and I'm just starting at the top here and reading down. I see judgment, sodomy, Obama, China, abortions, 2015, Fall of America, judgment, war, America, Obama, America, industry falls, 2015, Islam, sodomy, China again. Yeah. So a lot of those words you've been hearing on this broadcast was related to the Fall of America for a long time. So, I mean, I look at this thing and I say, you know, this is not an accident.
That's exactly right, brother. You know, when you find a search term, a original term, the first one you find, the access term, that's amazing. But when you start finding related terms after that that seem to point you in a certain direction, like, wow, this is serious. The Fall of America, judgment's coming. Then you start evaluating. Well, let's think about what's taking place in America. We've walked away from God. We've pushed God out of schools. You wonder why there's school shootings and things like that. Well, we took God out of schools. That's why there's shootings. You know, the abortion issue, the gay marriage stuff. Everything that's happened in with every generation, it's gotten worse and worse and worse, to the point now where we're at judgment time. You know, and another thing I've discovered from research from other people is the blood moons and the Shemitah cycles that have an influence of what we're looking at. It lays out a pattern that indicates that we're in the end of days. So all of these things taken into consideration with the codes is, you know, the codes is not definitive, the last word, but I can take in consideration other things as an investigation, these different patterns that seem to point to, you know, a certain direction. It's like triangulating the prophecies. You get different data points to validate or to, you know, to invalidate whatever you're looking for.
Well, part of what I think is fascinating, and maybe when we get time in another one of the programs to actually bring up what is the scripture, because many times the scripture where you find these codes, in other words, when you read it in the Bible, it's talking about the Fall of America, and lo and behold, there's a code under there that is talking about the Fall of America, and it's like that all throughout them. Is that correct?
That is. It usually what you'll find is in the context of the access term, you'll have a verse that either runs through it or is in the area of it that seems to have a relation. Well, I wasn't prepared to have the English translation of what we're looking at, but just one of the partial verse running right through the collapse of America is the words, the land of trouble and anguish. We're talking about the Fall of America, and here it is crossing right under the bottom of it. the words land of trouble and anguish.
Wow.
Yeah. And it's of course, we're plain text is talking about Israel and things that are going on in ancient times, but in the context of a code that changes everything, we're talking about something different now. We're talking about America and what's in this matrix.
We're about out of time, but so let me just tell you folks here, we're going to continue talking about this for the next several days. But in the meantime, and by the way, Jonathan, thank you so much for coming on Speaking to the Prophecy Club. I'll be looking forward to hearing all of this. Folks, again, if you'd like to have his DVD, it's going to be a double DVD set. You can call Prophecy Club and get it. And what the office doesn't even know, I just made this arrangement. Jonathan has agreed to allow his book in the text and also all of these charts. And I have to ask him, I'm going to say that there's well over 50, maybe 75 or even 100 charts. All of these are going to be on a separate CD that we're going to be including along with it. So to get two DVDs and the CD that has all of this all together, all for whatever the donation is, call Prophecy Club, they'll tell you, is going to be a great deal. So you're going to have roughly 5 hours of Jonathan explaining all these to you, showing you the charts, plus you're actually going to be able to have the charts to pull up on your computer and look. Here's how you get it. Go to prophecyclub.com or call 785-266-1112. Jonathan Wright and Prophecies in the Bible Codes. And he's going to be speaking Saturday night at 7 p.m., Sunday morning, 9:30, March 14 and 15, Prophecy Club, 2540 K Avenue in Plano. That's Saturday night, March 14, 7 p.m., Sunday morning, March 15, 9:30 to noon, Prophecy Club, 2540 K Avenue in Plano, right behind the Whataburger. Now from the Prophecy Club, some exciting opportunities for you. The next speaker at the Prophecy Club is Jonathan Wright. He's an authority on prophecies in the Bible Codes. He says not only do they validate the Bible, but they unseal the prophecies, such as who are the two witnesses? Is Obama the Antichrist? Will there be a third world war? Will America be nuked and fall? Who is the Mahdi? Will there be a caliphate? When does the rapture take place? What is the role of the Pope and Vatican? Will there be a third temple and much more? Jonathan will speak Saturday evening, 7 p.m. and Sunday morning, 9:30 to noon, March 14th and 15th. That's at the Prophecy Club, 2540 K Avenue in Plano. Order the DVD, Prophecy in the Bible Codes, at prophecyclub.com. Saturday night, 7 p.m., Sunday morning, 9:30 to noon, March 14 and 15, Prophecy Club, 2540 K Avenue in Plano, or order Prophecy in the Bible Codes at prophecyclub.com. Shocking heresy and blasphemy. Using over 100 video clips, you will see large, well-known ministers making shocking statements contrary to the Bible. So bad, you'll have to see it to believe it. See, some of most popular pastors seduce you with lying signs and wonders. Teach a false Christ. Yes, it is true. Your mouth will fall open. The worst sins of the Bible in these DVDs called Error in the Church. Nation-killing sins in America. You won't be disappointed. You'll be furious. Beyond angry. I thank God that Leslie showed me these shocking errors, and I would never have known it or believed it if I had not actually seen it. Call today and give a $50 gift, and we will immediately ship you the first three DVDs. 30 days later, we'll charge your card for the second $50 gift, then send you the final eight DVDs, totaling 11 DVDs. 30 days later, we'll charge the third $50 gift. 30 days later, the fourth and final $50 gift, making it easy for you to get this fantastic set of 11 DVDs. That is four monthly gifts of $50 each. Error in the Church, 13 topics, 11 DVDs, valued at $330. Get started today for a gift of just $50. Call 785-266-1112 and ask them for the Error in the Church offer. $50 donation gets you three DVDs heading your way today. Error in the Church, 785-266-1112. Error in the Church, 785-266-1112. Call today.